Welcome to iForum Rx, where we explore the evidence that informs ambulatory care pharmacy practice. Today we'll be discussing the manuscript entitled Efficacy and Safety of Canagliflozin versus Glimepiride in Patients with Type 2 Diabetes Inadequately Controlled with Metformin, which appeared in The Lancet, September 2013. Today's presentation will be given by Amanda Chartel, the PGY2 Ambulatory Care Pharmacy Resident at the University of Maryland School of Pharmacy.
In March 2013, the FDA approved canagliflozin, or Invokana, the first agent in a new class of oral medications used to treat type 2 diabetes. This new drug class is known as the SGLT2 inhibitors, or sodium glucose cotransporter 2 inhibitors. In January 2014, another SGLT2 inhibitor, dapagliflozin, or Farxiga, was approved by the FDA. Other SGLT2 inhibitors, such as empagliflozin, are currently in the research and development pipeline. Given the creation and rapid expansion of the SGLT2 inhibitor class, it is important to evaluate the role these new medications play in the management of diabetes. Over the next few minutes, we will review current diabetes management and how the SGLT2 inhibitors work, examine the design and results of the CANTATA-SU trial, and discuss how this evidence impacts patient care. Historically, clinical practice guidelines have supported the use of metformin as first-line therapy for patients newly diagnosed with diabetes. However, when patients fail metformin monotherapy, it has been less clear which agent to add to the patient's regimen next, given the multiple alternative therapies available. Typically, clinicians must compare the A1C lowering potential, additional benefits, adverse reactions, and cost of oral and injectable therapies in order to make a decision. As we can see from this diagram, this is the approach supported by the American Diabetes Association in its 2014 Standards of Medical Care in Diabetes. While the SGLT2 inhibitors have been approved since 2013, the ADA did not comment on their role in therapy in this year's standards. In contrast, the American Association of Clinical Endocrinologists did include SGLT2 inhibitors as options for monotherapy, dual therapy, or triple therapy in their 2013 diabetes management algorithm. They do note that this inclusion into the algorithm was only based on phase 3 clinical data at the time of publication. Like the ADA, the AACE recommends weighing the risks and benefits of the different classes of medications in relation to patient-specific factors before making a decision. Before we review the CANTATA-SU trial, it is important to understand how the SGLT2 inhibitors work. Normally, the kidneys regulate glucose in the body through sodium glucose cotransporters. SGLT2 is found in the proximal tubule and accounts for 90% of the glucose that is reabsorbed in the kidneys. SGLT2 inhibitors work by blocking renal reabsorption of sodium in the proximal tubule. This action, in turn, inhibits renal reabsorption of glucose as well. Urinary glucose excretion then increases and serum glucose returns to more normal levels. Due to its renal excretion, use of canagliflozin is contraindicated in patients with a creatinine clearance less than 30 milliliters per minute. There is also limited data suggesting a benefit in patients with creatinine clearance less than 45 milliliters per minute. Now that we understand how our SGLT2 inhibitors regulate glucose in the body, let's begin to understand the efficacy and safety of these agents so we can determine their role in the management of diabetes. The CANTATA-SU trial was designed to do just that. Researchers wanted to compare the efficacy and safety of the SGLT2 inhibitor canagliflozin with the sulfonylurea glimepiride as add-on therapy in patients with type 2 diabetes inadequately controlled on metformin monotherapy. The study enrolled 1,450 adult patients with type 2 diabetes and a baseline A1C between 7% and 9.5%. Patients also had to be on stable metformin therapy of 1,500 mg to 2,000 mg per day for at least 10 weeks prior to the study. Patients were excluded if they had a history of severe hypoglycemia, Repeated fasting blood sugars over 270 milligrams per deciliter during the pretreatment phase, or decreased renal function. Subjects were randomized to receive either glimepiride, titrated up to 6 or 8 milligrams daily, or canagliflozin at doses of 100 milligrams or 300 milligrams daily, in addition to their stable metformin therapy. Subjects were followed for 52 weeks, and changes in A1C and weight, as well as rates of hypoglycemia and other adverse events, were recorded. Baseline characteristics between the groups were similar. The average patient in the study was 56 years old, had diabetes for 6.5 years with an A1C of 7.8%, and weighed 87 kilograms with a BMI of 31 kilograms per meter squared, indicating obesity. There was a relatively even distribution of men and women in each group, and the majority of patients were Caucasian. Additionally, rates of discontinuation between the groups were similar. After 52 weeks of follow-up, both doses of canagliflozin were shown to be non-inferior to glimepiride in A1C reduction. Canagliflozin 100 mg and canagliflozin 300 mg lowered A1Cs an average of 0.82% and 0.93% respectively, compared to 0.81% for glimepiride. While canagliflozin 300 mg was found to be superior to glimepiride for A1C reduction, it was only a 0.12% difference in average A1C, which is not clinically significant. In comparison to glimepiride, which increased body weight at 52 weeks, both doses of canagliflozin significantly reduced body weight by about 4.5% at the end of the study. Patients in the canagliflozin groups lost around 4 kilograms by the end of the study, most of which was fat loss. Rates of hypoglycemia were significantly more in those patients receiving glimepiride compared to either of the canagliflozin doses. Additionally, rates of severe hypoglycemia, defined as an event requiring assistance of another person or resulting in a loss of consciousness or seizure, were higher with glimepiride than with canagliflozin. However, rates of severe hypoglycemia were low in all groups. While hypoglycemia was more common with glimepiride, there were certain adverse effects more frequently associated with canagliflozin treatment, including genital yeast infections, urinary tract infections, and increased urinary frequency. These findings generate a number of questions for discussion. In particular, what are the strengths of the CANTATA-SU study? Are there any potential weaknesses that threaten its internal or external validity? What are the potential advantages of the SGLT2 inhibitors? Is there a way we can predict, prevent, or mitigate the adverse effects of the SGLT2 inhibitors? And other than cost, are there any reasons to favor one SGLT2 inhibitor over another?
In order to help us answer these questions, I'd like to introduce our expert panel for a roundtable discussion. Dr. Sarah Anderson is an assistant professor at the University of Colorado School of Pharmacy and a board-certified pharmacotherapy specialist. Dr. Susan Cornell is the assistant director of experiential education and an adjunct associate professor at the Chicago College of Pharmacy of Midwestern University. She is a certified diabetes educator. Thank you both for joining the iForum discussion today. Our first question today will be, what are the strengths of the CANTATA-SU study? Are there any potential weaknesses that threaten its internal or external validity?
Well, thank you very much, Amanda, for having me this morning. It's a pleasure to be here. And a very interesting study. And I do believe it was done quite well, obviously a randomized, double-blind, multi-center, so large groups of people. Probably the biggest concern that I have in terms of the study is we're comparing apples and oranges. So we're looking at, obviously, two different drugs. Canagliflozin primarily focuses on fasting blood glucose.
I agree with what Dr. Cornell mentioned. I especially liked that this study was multinational in nature, so we had patients from different countries represented, although it was still about 67% white or Caucasian patients, not as diverse as it could have been from an ethnicity standpoint. I think another thing to point out about the study is that the average baseline A1C across groups ended up being 7.8%. In practice, we know not everyone is that close to their A1C goal, and so there isn't as much external validity for patients who might start this drug with a higher A1C.
So our second question is, given that we now have 11 different classes of medications for the treatment of type 2 diabetes to pick from, what do you see as the potential advantages of the SGLT2 inhibitors?
So I think that fortunately there are a lot of potential advantages for these new SGLT2 inhibitors. In clinical trials, what we've seen is that there tends to be little to no hypoglycemia associated with them. The SGLT2 inhibitors have also been shown to cause weight loss. And so even though this weight loss tends to plateau at about 26 weeks in most of the trials, these drugs are orally available, so patients like that. And once-a-day dosing is also a plus. And then we've also seen some potentially beneficial blood pressure reductions with the SGLT2 inhibitors.
Again, I agree. I agree with everything that Dr. Anderson said. She hit some very valid points about the drug class itself. And one of the things I think I'm looking forward to in this particular drug class, and where I think it has a potential advantage, is in type 1 patients. And I realize that's off-label, but there are studies currently going on right now that are looking at the benefit of using SGLT2s, because we do see so many of our type 1s that are developing metabolic syndrome, and this is a nice drug that will not cause weight gain and maybe help with the metabolic syndrome.
What are your thoughts about the adverse effect profile of the SGLT2 inhibitors? What do you perceive as their Achilles heel, and is there a way that we can predict, prevent, or mitigate these adverse effects?
As far as the side effects go, obviously there are some concerns, because especially in patients with diabetes, people with uncontrolled diabetes tend to have an increased risk of genital urinary tract infections. And once you get a lot of sugar going through the genital urinary tract, of course you're promoting growth for bacteria. So patients that are at high risk for these types of infections, that's where we probably need to kind of identify those folks early on, not use this class of drugs, use an alternative.
But I think it's important to point out that when these UTIs or these genital infections occurred, they tended to be mild in nature and were able to be treated by standard therapy. I do think it's also important to point out that with patients who develop these infections, they were more likely to get one during the trial if they had a history of UTIs or genital fungal infections. It's a good idea to look at a patient's history and look at, have they had UTIs in the past? Have they had issues with fungal infections? And if so, that's a good conversation to have with a patient. They might still choose to try the new agent, or they might say that I have a trouble with UTIs and I don't want a drug that's going to cause even more of them.
Now, Dr. Anderson, you alluded to kind of some of the other SGLT2 inhibitors are in the pipeline, and likely a number of other drugs will be added to this class over the next few years. Other than cost, are there any reasons you see to favor one SGLT2 inhibitor over another?
So I think that's a great question, and I think we'll know more about the differences and the nuances between them as we get more clinical experience with them. A lot of our decision-making points at this point in time relate back to, I think, just basic package insert type information. For instance, we would be able to use canagliflozin in patients with more severe renal impairment. And then lastly, I think, is there availability in combination with other agents? In Europe, there's a canagliflozin-metformin combination, as well as a dapagliflozin-metformin combination. And of course, from a patient adherence standpoint, from a cost standpoint, combo products tend to be very beneficial, might also lend you to choose one product over another.
The biggest thought process that I have on this is time will tell. As we know, we can look all we want into clinical trials and evaluate them, but most of our patients that we treat are not patients that are involved in clinical trials. So I think that's where it'll be interesting when this gets out into the masses to see how our patients are responding. So I think, again, time will tell.
Wonderful. Thank you both again for your insight and commentary on the CANTATA SU trial.
Thanks again to Dr. Anderson and Dr. Cornell for their insight and commentary on the CANTATA SU trial. In summary, this landmark study suggests that canagliflozin is effective in the management of type 2 diabetes with the added benefits of modest weight loss and low rates of hypoglycemia. However, canagliflozin is associated with genitourinary infections and increased urinary frequency. Therefore, use of this agent may be beneficial to those patients requiring weight loss or at risk for hypoglycemia. Canagliflozin should be avoided in patients at risk for recurrent genitourinary infections or poor adherence due to increased urinary frequency, as well as in patients with moderate or severe renal impairment. Also, canagliflozin can potentially increase the risk of hyperkalemia, so serum potassium should be monitored in high-risk patients, including those with renal impairment and those concurrently taking ACE inhibitors, ARBs, and potassium-sparing diuretics. What are your thoughts about the CANTATA-SU trial? How should the evidence be applied to patient care? We would love to hear your thoughts and welcome your comments.
Thank you for viewing this CaptaCast and for your comments. This broadcast was brought to you by iForum Rx, examining the evidence that informs ambulatory care practice.